Ken, you're the filmmaker. How long have you been working on this project?
This is the culmination of a four-year effort. We started, my subtraction works, 2009. I first realized there had not been a documentary done about Wally Hickel, and I said, well, why not? And that started the whole effort.
Yeah, he's an amazing character, an Alaskan in every sense of the word.
Well, he is an Alaskan, and I think he was first and foremost an Alaskan, but he's also a great American and a world figure, and that is kind of reflected in the title of the movie, Alaska, the World, and Wally Hickel.
You know, it's interesting. A lot of times you talk about characters as being complex or sophisticated and subtle. Hickel was what he was. Would you call him complex?
You wouldn't call him subtle. And I don't think you would call him sophisticated in the way we normally use the word. But he was difficult to stereotype. He confounded friend and foe alike.
Yes, frequently.
So you could not put him or predict what he was going to do most of the time.
But he had a big spirit always. He took things in the largest scale he could find them.
He did. He has a phrase which I just fell in love with the first time I heard it. When I first met him back in 1986, it was, why war, why not big projects? And the context of that was, it was about 10 years after the Trans-Alaska Pipeline had started. So the Alaskans were reaping the benefits of all of that. Second, they were talking and were very optimistic a gas pipeline would follow that.
Yes.
It hasn't, but Wally Hickel, to his last days, thought that this was going to happen. He just never gave up.
You know, one of the people who's in the film, surprisingly to some people, is Victor Fisher.
Yes.
Who came from a kind of a different point of view politically, but he and Wally became good friends over the years. And he said something I thought that was interesting in the film. He said, everywhere Wally went, he made a splash.
Yes.
And as the ripples went out, he thought bigger.
Right, right. I thought Vic was a great spokesman, particularly in this time where you have such polarization in politics. You had people who were nominally a Republican and a Democrat or liberal and a conservative or something.
Yeah.
Wally wouldn't describe himself that way, but most others would, who became very, very close friends and fought battles on the same side when it was necessary for Alaska.
Was there anything in Wally's record that surprised you? I mean, this guy was full of twists and turns that you would never have predicted, but after the end of the research, did you get surprised?
Yeah, I don't think we have enough time for me to list the surprises.
Give me the top three.
I'll give you three from just his short period of time as Secretary of the Interior. Wally Hickel put whales on the endangered species list.
Yes.
Wally Hickel.
Save the whales, Wally.
Who would have known? Go figure. Wally Hickel made the oil companies absolutely liable for the cleanup costs of any oil spill. The man who got criticized when he was being confirmed as big businessman, big friend of big oil. He got $1 billion out of Exxon, the biggest settlement at the time in a civil suit to clean up the Exxon Valdez spill. The Exxon executives, told to me by people who were in the room, went ballistic. $1 billion? Are you kidding? But they paid it.
And he got it.
And he got it.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's more. There's a lot.
There was a famous story at the time in the early 90s when he was governor and he was deciding how to pursue the Exxon settlement thing. Yeah. And I think he had a punching bag in his office. And he would go up and punch the bag a little to get his exercise and clear his head a little bit. And he had one of these famous stories where he did that for a while and he came back and told everybody, we're going to go get him now.
Yeah, yeah. And he also was a good delegator. People who worked for him for a long time always felt that he was able to give them the general direction. Just like you said, let's go get him. And they'd go get him, but he didn't have to know every blow-by-blow detail about what they were going to do.
Probably the most central and interesting story in the film is the account of when he wrote a very provocative letter to Richard Nixon as president, saying we need to listen to the youth. They've got something to say and you're not listening enough.
Right.
And it's a fascinating account, really, at this point.
Yeah, it is. I don't want to claim that we're making history here, but until we interviewed Joe Hulbert, it was never admitted, and certainly Wally Hickel never admitted in his life that he leaked the letter.
Right. But Joe admitted it in the film.
Joe admitted it, and it was confirmed by one of the journalists to whom he leaked it, whose name I can't say for obviously journalistic ethical reasons. But yeah, it all seems to point to the fact that he probably did it. But this is a, so this was huge news at the time.
Yes.
It was front page news, not in Alaska. Alaskans were used to seeing Wally Hickel on the front page. But the rest of America probably didn't know who the Secretary of the Interior was, or and probably doesn't know today who the Secretary of the Interior is. Yeah. But he was on the front page of the New York Times, the Washington Post, every paper in the country. And as they say, it hit the fan. And Nixon went ballistic. Pat Buchanan, who was in the White House at the time, told us.
Great clips of him in the film.
Yeah, you know, what the feeling was at the time. And it was just the big story of that week. Of course, it happened right after the Kent State killings, in addition to the invasion of Cambodia. So the country was in turmoil. And Wally, like many others, was personally in turmoil over it.
Well, one of the historians you quoted in the film talked about how it may not have been handled the most effective way, and it was a big ruckus that maybe wasn't necessary, but that Hickel had something right. He was understanding something about the mood of the country and the changes in the mood of the country.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, though, do you think he accomplished anything with it, or was it a futile effort?
I do think he accomplished something. I think that it affected Nixon. We tell that very unusual story of Nixon going out to talk to the demonstrators on the Mall, protesting, and it was you can't tell. There was not a cause and effect relationship, but I think, you know, it was the right thing to do for him. He felt he had to do it, whether it was effective or not, and I think it did stop some of the violence, I think.
Didn't exactly fit the brief of the normal Secretary of Interior, did it?
Oh, no, not at all. He was told by other members of the cabinet to butt out of this stuff, to not get involved in it. Wally said, well, you're here, and you want my opinion, you know, and everybody else's opinion, don't you? And they said, well, really. Wally, this was a quote from one of the cabinet members. Wally, just go worry about your buffalo. They didn't want to hear it.
But he saw the cabinet as being the government.
Right.
In the executive branch anyway.
And Pat Buchanan says quite clearly, you know, we made policy from the White House, and the secretaries followed the orders. Yeah. Well, that was not the way Wally didn't take orders.
Yeah.
Not very well.
Anyway.
Anytime. Maybe from Irma Lee Hickel he took orders, but not from anybody else.
Yeah. There's a story, you know, in the film, and the part of the legend, the myth of Wally Hickel, is that he arrived in Seward in 1940, I believe, with 37 cents in his pocket.
Right.
And I've always had this question in the back of my mind when you hear the 37-cent story, mm-hmm. which is, well, that'd probably buy him one, maybe two meals,
right.
But what did he do to get the third meal?
Right, right. A lot of these stories have been repeated over and over, and they've become legend. There's no way to know whether he had 37 or 47 or $1.48. So we have to just accept the fact that he didn't have that much money. And he tells a story, I believe it's in Who Owns America, his first book, which he wrote right after he was fired by Nixon. But he said that you know, he borrowed some money from somebody, you know, made his way up to Anchorage, scraped around, found some jobs, and
which was a very Alaskan way to go. You'd borrow your steak, and then you'd sit down and go to work.
Yeah.
That book actually caused a bit of a stir in the late 70s. I remember long ago, this is 30 years ago now, I reviewed that book in the Anchorage Daily News. Do you think it holds up at this point?
There are some things in that book that blew me away when I read them fairly recently, maybe two, three years ago. There's a quote in there, it's on the actual inside of the jacket, the dust cover, which says something like this. I'm going to get it wrong because I'll paraphrase it. But there's something wrong with a country, in which a man can't get $500 to fix his boat, but will bail out the big banks so that they can continue to operate. You could have written that quote last year or 3 years ago when all the economic crisis happened.
And what's that line, that the more things change, the more they
stay
the same?
The more they stay the same. So that book, you know, has those kinds of stories. And then, you know, of course, there's stories there that you can't verify. And we were scrupulous in the documentary. We created a script, annotated script with 170 footnotes so that we can defend everything that we say in the movie. Now, we can't defend everything that the interview subjects say if we know they happen to be wrong about a date or something, we don't use it. But this is scrupulously researched, and I think it's every line in it is defendable.
Hickel was a dynamic and a tough businessman. Before he was a politician, he was a guy who got to Anchorage with however many cents in his pocket and built a company, didn't know anything about construction, and got into the construction business and wound up owning and building a lot of the properties that are all over Anchorage, including the Captain Cook Hotel, which a lot of people think of as the core of downtown. But he was a tough businessman, and he had a lot of good luck. He arrived in Anchorage at the start of World War II, and then he rode the defense boom in the 1950s. And he had faith after the Alaska earthquake of 64. He said, I'm building at the west end of 4th Avenue. And it all worked, right? But did he have any periods where he had business reverses, where it didn't work, where that faith was not rewarded?
You know, I don't really know. There was not a lot that we found about the early years and the ups and downs of the business. So I really don't know the answer to that.
And what about, so we know that in his political life, he had some ups and downs.
Plenty of ups
and downs. Never seemed to look back, never felt bad, just moved forward.
Right.
How did he keep that big spirit alive?
I think it's something innate in him. His mother said that Wally was different. And it came, she said that to Wally's sisters in Kansas when Wally climbed up to the roof of some building, very dangerous because he was young. And he came down and his mother didn't yell at him. So they said, why don't you yell at Wally? You always yell at us. And she said to him, Wally is different.
Wow.
And he was just a fearless guy.
Yeah.
He was very confident. Now, sometimes fear can be reckless and confident can be overconfident. But he had other qualities that tempered it. And I think that you know, he was internally optimistic, and that is the rare quality.
Yeah.
The confidence, fearlessness, they're more common.
Did you ever find any evidence of any self-doubt in Wally Hickel?
I did not. I didn't find 1 ounce of self-doubt. In fact, even at the beginning of this project, Wally Hickel was already about 87, maybe he had turned 88 by then. And I was moaning and groaning, you know, these are hard to do, Governor Hickel. You know, I'm not sure. We'll give it a try. And he goes, no, Ken, no. We can get this done. You just put that out there. People, they're responding. Trust me, they're going to respond. Well, I guess.
Took a couple years, but here we are.
He told me. It was amazing. I remember it just so distinctly. He was boundless in his enthusiasm, even for a project like this. And he didn't know it was going to be, you know, as favorable as it turned out to be. We didn't start out to make it that way, but that's how it turned out because that was the judgment we made.
Yeah.
You know, Wally would tend to exaggerate his accomplishments.
Yeah.
One situation where he was a participant in it, you know, he became the primogenitor of it. You know, he would, not that he wouldn't give credit to others, but this, he had a role in it and he touted his role. And we looked at this pretty carefully and we said, well, you know, look, a politician exaggerating his accomplishments, you know, take a number.
Surprise,
you know, take a number, you know. I mean, find me a politician that doesn't do that. So that was part of the story. And it's in there. And it's told very well by both Vic Fisher, who knew Wally and had seen him do this, and Terrence Cole has a wonderful phrase where he describes Wally's exaggerations or embellishments as well-polished stones. They're, you know, told, lying there, the water running over them so long, they just become, you know, part of the landscape.
I think one of the things about many politicians, and certainly with Wally, is they really truly believe these embellishments and exaggerations. and they carry them off without any hint of doubt or uncertainty.
Yeah, you know, he's not a perfect guy, and I think, you know, you see that in the stories that we tell in the movie, the early years of his governorship, where he, like most non-Alaska natives, didn't get what are they so upset about?
Yeah.
He thought about the Alaska natives, you know, and then finally, you know, he had political reasons, but he also had reasons that he finally understood.
Yeah.
The real reasons, you know, to why that was important. And I think the outcome turned out well for everybody in the end.
But, you know, he went forward and he made the deals.
Yeah.
Right? He did not stand so firm on principle or on belief or whatever that he couldn't make a deal.
Right. Are you talking about current day politics now?
Well, you could find an echo there.
Okay. You might. Just a little.
But, you know, one of his adversaries when he was governor at the first time was Willie Hensley.
Yes.
And they fought tooth and nail, and they made a deal, ultimately.
Yes.
And now, you know, Willie appears in the film, and yeah. In both of their older age, they became good friends and colleagues in working for Alaska.
Yeah, they are, you know, Willie was very careful. He did not want to sanitize the story, and he told it like it was in a bite in the movie. He says, you know, they were going to just, you know, push us out of the way and live happily ever after. And we said we couldn't let that happen. So it was, you know, and then of course oil in Alaska changed everything. And everybody could benefit from that.
One thing that wasn't that I saw in the film was how something that Wally used to talk a lot about was his role in convincing ARCO to go drill on the slope when they made the first discovery.
Yeah, it's a complicated story. The land had wisely been selected by Bill Egan as part of the state's allocation from the federal government, because many people had been poking around up there and suspected there would be oil there. So that was a wise choice. But they actually had to go up and drill up there. And there's a story which we don't say, talk about in the show, but it's quoted much, a Hickelism, you might say. It was, you know, drill or I will, allegedly told the head of ARCO or somebody up there.
Yeah.
And
the guy looked at him with a shocked expression and finally believed he might.
So, but we don't know if that really happened. So we couldn't corroborate it, so we left it out.
Uh-huh.
But he did, we can corroborate that he gave ARCO the ability to drill more up there, test wells, to discovery wells. And he did that over the objections of Alaska natives who had already claimed that land or some of it. And they also, you know, over the objections of ARCO, were sort of getting fed up because they weren't finding anything up there. And he said, well, if I give you more, if I let you go further out, will you do it? And they were just about to stop, and they struck oil.
Well, that's one of the stories he told many times around here and became part of the legend.
Yeah.
Would you call him larger than life?
Oh, yeah.
How much larger?
I don't know what the scale is of larger than life. He is an original. There was nobody like him. I've met a handful of people, I think most people. If you meet people that you know are different, and you don't exactly know why or how they got that way, but you know something's going on, it attracts your interest. And I think he distinguished himself in the end because he decided that he thought he had figured out the way to end poverty on the planet Earth. Now this, he didn't know, we don't know how we would make that happen.
Yeah.
But it was a really, really intriguing idea. And he based it on his experience in Alaska. He said every Alaskan benefits from the wealth that we have in Alaska from the oil. How much did you get a check this year from the permanent fund?
We all got a piece.
We all got something. Well, if you could do this with the vast wealth that exists on this planet, if the people could benefit, the many could benefit, not the few, that would help alleviate poverty, wouldn't it? Well, how do you make it happen? That's where you got to put the muscle and the skin and the sinews on the skeleton that he proposed.
Ken, as a filmmaker, how often do you get a subject like this?
Well, I think I've had one or two others in my career, which is over 30 years now. The first one was a man who I did not meet, but there were still people around who knew him. That was General George Marshall. And he was different, too. It was duty to him. He had to serve the country. He had to do what was right, just like Wally felt he did. And I would be hard pressed to find another. They come around once in a generation, maybe twice.
That's pretty high. Impressive company.
Yeah, the bar is pretty high, I think.
One of the surprises I think everybody had about Wally Hickel was when he shut down Santa Barbara Channel to drilling.
Yeah.
Was there anything that you learned about him in that episode that didn't make it into the film but might be interesting?
Well, that was a transformative moment for Wally Hickel. He had just come through a horrible confirmation process where he was accused of being both a friend of big business and a friend of big oil. And he was also taken to task on a statement he made about the native claims, or the land freeze, that was as it was called. So he had been bloodied, but he'd just gotten confirmed, and then the oil spill takes place 4 days later, and he goes out there that weekend. And initially he says, well, you know, I don't really know what's going on yet, so I'm not shutting anybody down. And then he gets in a plane, and it's the first shot of the movie. And you see him looking at that. And he realizes, you know, we've got to do something. This is not right. And he does shut the oil companies down. And it gets complicated.
Yeah,
goes
right.
Back and forth and back and forth. And he wasn't the only one involved. And the Nixon administration had a very angry Republican congressman representing Santa Barbara who wanted something done. But he stepped to the plate. And we went into great detail in our research to confirm that, you know, that he stood up, and he gives a good speech, and there's a good clip in there that says, you know, we can't abuse nature because the bill is coming due, and this is it. Mm-hmm. So I don't think anybody expected that to come out of Wally Hickel's mouth, not in 1969.
Mm-hmm. What's next, Ken?
Well, I'm going to catch my breath and decide, but I'll be happy to come back up to Alaska to do another documentary.
Well, we have another historic figure around here that Wally Hickel had a role in creating, which was when Wally, in 1968, only a little while before he went to Washington with Richard Nixon, he appointed Ted Stevens as U.S. Senator when former Senator Bob Bartlett died.
Yeah.
And Ted went on to become the longest sitting Republican senator in American history.
Right.
So there you go.
Yeah, that could be the next one. The story that Terrence Cole tells, and not in the show but on the website, is that Ted Stevens said that he was elected to the United States Senate by one vote, and that vote was Wally Hickel's vote.
Wally Hickel.
Yeah.
Well, listen, thanks so much for the film and for the interview here today.
Great. Well, thanks. Great. Thanks, Steve.